Hello. So, let us continue for our lecture from where we left yesterday. Even before that, let us revise what we studied in the previous lecture. In our previous lecture, we saw that how we can represent a complex number of the form r, theta, even exponentially as r into e to the power iota theta, where r is the modulus of the complex number and theta is its argument. The next thing that we saw was how we can represent any complex number as a vector on the Argand plane. So that, for example, I have a point OP which as r comma theta or r cos theta plus I sin theta, I can always represent it as r I xi cap plus yj cap on the complex plane. As an exercise, we even saw how we can represent addition and multiplication of two complex numbers on Argand plane, and we left division and subtraction as an exercise for us. I suppose everyone could easily represent division and subtraction of complex number on Argand plane. Just for a sanity sake, I am drawing it once again so that you all can tally. This, let us just do it very quickly and then start our next topic. So first, let us start by representing division of two complex number. Say this is my first point P, which has modulus r1, an angle theta1, and this is my another point Q, which is having modulus r2, an angle theta 2. What we have to represent? We have to represent a point whose modulus is r1 by r2 and argument is theta 1 minus theta 2. So let us first draw a line on this xy plane whose argument is theta 1 minus theta 2. Now on this line, I have to locate a point r such that its modulus or is equals to r1 by r2. So before that, I am taking a point A on this x axis, real axis, such that this length OA is equals to 1, and I am doing one more thing. I am taking a point r on this line with argument theta 1 minus theta 2 such that this the angle PRO would be angle to this angle OAP. So this is my angle OAP, and I am taking a point R on this line such that angle PRO is equal to angle QAO. So now let us consider these two triangles. Let us consider triangle OPR and triangle OQA. So considering triangle OPR and triangle OQA, what we have, we know is angle POR would be angle equal to angle QOA, which is equal to theta 1. Angle OAQ is equal to angle ORP. This is because we have drawn, taken R in such a way that angle PRO would be equal to angle QAO. So by AA similarity, I can say that both these two triangles are similar. So applying similarity in this case, what I get is OR upon OQ. Sorry. OR upon OA is equals to OP upon OQ. When I solve this, what I get is OR is equals to R1 divided by R2. So R represents a point with modulus R1 by R2 and argument theta 1 minus theta 2 on the complex plane. This is nothing but the complex representation of division of two complex number. Similarly, we can even represent addition of two complex number. Let us use the same xy plane. This is my xy plane I have one complex number Z1 and another complex number Z2. What we have to represent is the division of, is the subtraction of Z1 minus Z2. So what I have to represent is Z1 minus Z2. As discussed yesterday, I can write this as Z1 plus minus of Z2. So minus of Z2 would be a complex number with argument minus of pi minus theta, if this angle is theta, and modulus same as equals to Z2. So I am drawing a complex number with modulus same as Z2 and argument as pi minus theta. So this angle is theta, so this is my complex number minus Z2. Now we saw yesterday addition of two complex number is represented by the diagonal of their parallelogram. So I am drawing a line, so I am drawing a parallelogram to complete these two, and I know that the diagonal of this parallelogram is going to represent with the addition of Z1 and minus Z2, which represents nothing but Z1 minus Z2. I hope you all would have solved both these two questions in the same way. Now this is all that we had discussed yesterday. The last topic that we were discussing yesterday was how we can represent locus of lots of a set of points on complex plane or the argand plane. We had seen how we can find out angle between two intersecting lines. We even saw that how by multiplying a complex number by e to the power iota theta, we can rotate it by an angle theta in anti-clockwise direction, and similarly by multiplying it by e to the power minus iota theta, we can rotate it in clockwise direction. We even saw how we can shift origin in case of complex number the way we used to do it in case of real number. Now the next topic that we are going to discuss under coordinate geometry of complex number is how we can find an inverse of a point with respect to a line. So one thing that we are seeing here is all the things that we studied in case of real numbers, especially all the coordinate geometry we studied in case of real number, we are again studying in case of complex number, because the point is still the same. The way we could represent real numbers, we are representing complex numbers. So all the concepts that used to apply for real numbers are almost valid even in case of complex number. So the next topic that we are going to start under the coordinate geometry of complex number is inverse of a point. Let us first define inverse of a point. I say Z1 and Z2 are said to be inverse of each other with respect to a line RS if Z1 is the mirror image of Z2 with respect to the line RS. I'll explain what I want to say. If this is a line RS, RS, this is my point Z1, then its mirror image, then the inverse of Z1 is the mirror image of Z1 with respect to this line RS. So if Z2 is the inverse of Z1, I can say that Z2 is the mirror image of Z1 with respect to this line RS, or what I can say is RS is the perpendicular bisector of the line Z1, Z2. Once again I am repeating, I say Z1 is said to be the inverse of Z2, Z2 is said to be the inverse of Z1 with respect to this line RS if Z2 is the mirror image of Z1, which even implies that RS is the perpendicular bisector of this line joining Z1 and Z2. Now let us solve one question based upon this so that we can understand this concept more clearly. So let us solve this question to apply the concept of inverse of a point with respect to a straight line. So the question that we have to solve is, we have been given a line ZA bar plus A bar AZ bar plus B equals to 0, and we are given that Z1 and Z2 are two points which are inverse of each other with respect to this line, and we have to prove is this thing, that is Z1 A bar plus AZ2 bar plus B equals to 0. Now let us first try to plot the complete situation that we have. We are given a line that ZA bar plus AZ bar plus B equals to 0. So let us draw a line and let us call this line as RS for now. And we are given that Z1 and Z2 are inverse of each other with respect to this line. So let us say this is point Z1 and this is point Z2. Z1 be represented by A and Z2 be represented by B. And let us take a point Q on this line RS. Now since Z1 and Z2 are inverse of each other with respect to this line RS, we can say that Z1 is the mirror image of Z2, and we can even say that RS is the perpendicular bisector of this line Z1, Z2. So any point that lies on RS would be equidistant from A and B. So I can always say if Q is a point on RS, then AQ will always, mod of AQ will always be equal to mod of BQ. I hope everyone is comfortable with what I have written. What I am saying is, if PQ, RS is the perpendicular bisector of AB, then any point Q which lies on RS is equidistant from A and B. This is what I have written here, AQ would be equal to BQ. Let the affix of this point Q be Z, then I can always write AQ as mod of Z minus Z1 and BQ as mod of Z minus Z2. On expanding this, what I get is Z minus Z1 into Z minus Z1 bar is equals to Z minus Z2 into Z minus Z2 bar. What I have done is I have squared this thing and I have expanded. I know that mod of Z square is equal to Z into Z bar. When I expand this completely, we have already seen the expansion of this in some previous question. I am just writing the expansion directly. What I will get is Z into Z1 bar minus Z2 bar plus Z bar into Z1 minus Z2 is equals to mod Z1 square minus mod Z2 square. I hope everyone is comfortable with what I have written here. Now, what we have got here is an equation in terms of Z. And Z is what? Z is any arbitrary line which lies on which arbitrary point which lies on this RS. So I can say this equation in terms of Z is nothing but equation for line RS. And we have been already given one more equation for this line RS in the question. So I can say this equation is equals to this equation. That is Z of A bar plus A Z bar is equals to minus B. Since both these equations are equal, I can compare their coefficients. So I can always write A bar upon Z1 bar minus Z2 bar is equals to A upon Z1 minus Z2 is equals to minus B upon mod Z1 square minus mod Z2 square. I hope everyone is comfortable with this. It is just that since these two equations are equal, we can compare their coefficients. That is what I have written there, the comparison of their coefficients. Now I am multiplying this term by Z1 and this term by Z2 bar. So what I get here is A bar into Z1 is equals to Z1 to Z1 bar minus Z2 bar is equals to A Z2 bar into Z2 bar Z1 minus Z2 is equals to minus B mod Z1 square minus mod Z2 square. Now applying the property of proportions, I can add this all and say A bar Z1 plus A Z2 bar minus B is equals to 0. This is what they had to prove here. So we have derived what we had to prove. Once again, I will explain what we wanted to do. We were given that Z1 and Z2 are inverse of each other with respect to this line RS. So we could say that any point that lies on this RS is equidistant from A and B. We took a point, arbitrary point Q on RS, and said that AQ would be equal to BQ. We know that AQ is nothing but mod of Z minus Z1, and this is mod of Z minus Z2. We expanded this completely and got the result that we wanted to obtain. So this is what, this is we had seen how we can obtain inverse of a point with respect to a line. The way we can obtain inverse of a point with respect to a line, we can all even obtain inverse of a point with respect to a circle. Let us see how we can define inverse of a point with respect to a circle. So now let us solve a question based upon inverse of a point with respect to a circle. Let us say we are given a point alpha and a circle represented by mod Z minus C equals to R. This shows that for this circle, C is the center and R is the radius. And we have to find inverse of point alpha with respect to this line, this circle, mod Z minus C equals to R. Let us draw the situation first. Let us say this is my circle with center C and radius R. This is my point alpha, and let us call the inverse of alpha to be alpha dash. So I have to find the coordinates of this point alpha dash, the value of this point alpha dash. Now as per the first condition of inverse of a point with respect to a circle, we can say, we know that C alpha and alpha dash are collinear, or I can say that for alpha dash to be the inverse of alpha with respect to the circle, C alpha and alpha dash has to be collinear. Or this even means that argument of alpha dash minus C would be equal to argument of alpha minus C. Once again, what I have written is, since C alpha and alpha dash are collinear, so argument of this line alpha minus C would be equal to argument of alpha dash minus C. I can even write this as argument of alpha dash minus C. I can write argument of alpha minus C as minus of argument of alpha minus C conjugate, because we always know that argument of Z bar is equals to minus argument of Z. This is what I have written here. So this turns out to be argument of alpha dash minus C plus argument of alpha minus C conjugate is equals to 0. This is equals to argument of alpha dash minus C into alpha minus C conjugate is equals to 0. What I have got here is, I have got a complex number alpha dash minus C into alpha minus C conjugate, and I say that the argument of this complex number is 0. That is, when I want to represent this complex number on my xy plane, this complex number lies on the positive side of the x axis. So I can say this complex number, that is alpha dash minus C into alpha minus C conjugate, lies on the positive direction of x axis. That this means this complex number is real, and even positive. I'll once again explain what I want to say here. From this equation, I've got a complex number whose argument is 0. And how do we represent a point with argument 0 on the complex plane? On a complex plane, such a point would be represented on the positive direction of x-axis. This means that this complex number is going to lie in the positive direction of x-axis, which means that this complex number is both positive as well as real. This is what I have written here. Now let us apply the second property related to inverse of a point. The second property says that C, if this alpha is represented by P and alpha dash is represented by Q, then Cp into Cq has to be R square. So here Cp is nothing but alpha minus C, mod of alpha minus C, and Cq is nothing but mod of alpha dash minus C. By definition, this has to be equals to R square. So I can write this as alpha minus C into alpha dash minus C mod whole square. Since we know that mod of Z1 into mod of Z2 is equals to mod of Z1 Z2, I applied the same concept here. Or one more step even before doing this, what I can do is I can write mod of alpha minus C as mod of alpha minus C conjugate into alpha dash minus C equals to R square. Since we always know, I'll try to explain what why I've taken this step. But before that, I just want to tell you why how this is possible. We always know that mod of Z is equals to mod of Z bar. This is what I've done here. Mod of alpha minus C as mod of alpha minus C conjugate. Now I'll try to explain why I've taken this step. When I was solving this equation, I got the equation what I got was alpha minus C conjugate into alpha dash minus C is a real number. And when I had written this equation, I got this result. So I just wanted to convert this complete term in terms of this complex number. That is the reason why I had taken the conjugate of this number. Now I know mod of Z1 into mod of Z2 is equals to mod of Z1 Z2. So I can write this as mod of alpha minus C conjugate into alpha dash minus C is equals to R square. Now from this equation, I know that alpha dash minus C into alpha minus C conjugate represents a real number, real and a positive positive number. So I can write mod of alpha minus C conjugate into alpha dash minus C directly as alpha minus C conjugate into alpha dash minus C. I can easily replace this modulus directly by this complex number because I'm very sure that this complex number is both real and positive. Solving this, what I get is alpha dash is equals to R square upon alpha minus C conjugate plus C. This is the value of alpha dash, which is what? Which is the inverse of point P with respect to this circle, mod of Z minus C equals mod of Z minus C equals to R. I'll once again try to explain what we have done. We have applied the first condition for alpha dash to be the inverse of alpha with respect to this circle, mod Z minus C equals to 0. So by that first condition, we know that C alpha and alpha dash are collinear. So I can always write argument of alpha dash minus C is equals to argument of alpha minus C. I have written argument of alpha minus C as minus of argument of alpha minus C conjugate because we know that argument of Z conjugate is equals to minus argument of Z. Solving this, we got what we got was alpha dash minus C into alpha minus C bar C conjugate is a real and a positive number. when we applied the second condition, we got alpha minus c conjugate, mod of alpha minus c conjugate into alpha dash minus c was equals to r square. Now from this equation we know that this number is real and positive, so I can easily remove this modulus sign. So I got this equation. I'm solving this equation, we got the value of alpha. I hope everyone is comfortable with this complete solution. Now let us proceed to the next topic, which is how we can apply section formula in case of complex numbers.